We've looked at our Milky Way, now it's time to look at galaxies. This is a beautiful mosaic of galaxies taken with the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, their colors indicating their stellar populations and ages, and the beautiful morphologies of spirals and ellipticals, edge-on, face-on, gorgeous subjects of astronomy. If you want to get involved in classifying galaxies, you can do citizen science with Galaxy Zoo, highly recommended. What is the nature of the nebulae? Let's recover the conversation that was being had at the end of the 19th century. There was uncertainty over the nature of the nebulae. They'd been cataloged by Messier, the comet hunter, and by William Herschel. And some had obvious spiral structure, and so did look like we imagined the Milky Way to be. The conventional view, however, was that they were nearby objects, hundreds or maybe thousands of light years, star-forming regions in the Milky Way. However, others, like Immanuel Kant, argued more radically that they were remote systems of stars, island universes, to use the phrase he used. They do tend to avoid the plane of the Milky Way galaxy, and since star formation occurs in the disk of the Milky Way, we might expect star formation regions that were nebulae to be concentrated there. Whereas the nebulae cataloged by Messier and Herschel tend to avoid the plane and be found at large angles from the plane, and so that constitutes weak support for the island universe hypothesis. You can see how the pictures of these objects looked when they had to be drawn by hand at the dawn of photography. Here on the left, you see M51 as drawn by William Herschel and by Lord Rosse, who had a huge telescope in Ireland, and the modern view with the Hubble Space Telescope. So Rosse's telescope did a pretty good job of showing the structure and morphology of M51, a nearby galaxy. On the right, we see Herschel's model of essentially the universe. He thought the universe was a big Milky Way with the sun, the yellow dot, quite near the center. And so this was the fundamental debate. And it was turned into a formal debate in 1920 when Harlow Shapley and Heber Curtis got together at the National Academy of Sciences with a large audience of scientists and the general public to argue the two hypotheses. And we see the hypotheses in schematic form on the lower right. Harlow Shapley believed that the Milky Way galaxy was actually much larger than it really is. His distance estimates were way off. And he thought that what we call the nebulae, the red patches, were objects within the Milky Way itself. In a very large Milky Way, these were the nebulae. Curtis, however, thought that the Milky Way galaxy was much smaller than Shapley. His distance estimates were different, and he believed that the nebulae were as large as the Milky Way and displaced from it, separate stellar systems. Now, it turns out both sides were hampered by things they didn't know, in particular the effect of dust, and more particularly the way to measure distance. All they could do was use the apparent size of objects and a local proxy to guess how far away they were, or the apparent brightness of an object and a local proxy to guess how far away an object was. These methods are really uncertain. And in the end, we recognize in the scientific method that questions of science that are this profound are not really resolved by debates at all, but by observation and experiment. So that's what came next. And what came next was one of the pioneer astronomers of the 20th century, and probably the leading observational astronomy of the whole century. The Hubble Space Telescope, NASA's premier facility for almost three decades, is named after him for a good reason. He was a stunning astronomer. He studied law. He was an excellent athlete. He was a Rhodes Scholar. He joined the Army and rose to the rank of major in World War I. He was also, to be honest, fairly full of himself and never let anyone forget that he was an Army major and had people address him that way if they were of inferior academic rank. He had a healthy ego, maybe beyond healthy. He was also lucky at some level because he benefited from a relationship with the master telescope builder of the early 20th century, George Ellery Hale. George Ellery Hale was a master fundraiser and entrepreneur and an architect of large telescopes. He'd built the 60-inch on Mount Wilson early in the century. He then built the 100-inch on Mount Wilson, which Hubble used for his discovery of the distance to galaxies. And then he moved to Caltech and Carnegie and built the Mount Palomar 200-inch. So those were three successive world's largest telescopes built by Hale. and Hubble got to use all three. The breakthrough in measuring the distance to the nebulae came when Hubble discovered what is called a Cepheid variable star in M31. What is a Cepheid variable star? It's a variable star, and for the purpose of his discovery, all we really need to know is that it pulsates, and you see an animation of its pulsation time. The pulsation time can be as short as a few hours, or as long as weeks, or even a couple of months. And what people had found from observing a set of these pulsating variable stars in the Milky Way with known distances measured by parallax, so we could get the luminosities, is that there was a very clear and clean linear relationship, seen on the bottom left, between their luminosity or intrinsic brightness and their period. So the longer period pulsating variables are more luminous, the shorter period are less luminous. And that means if we understand these stars and how they behave, or just the fact that they behave in this way, we can measure a period and infer a luminosity or an absolute brightness, because we're using the calibration of this relation for local Cepheids in the Milky Way. So, if we go to a distant region of space, such as Andromeda, M31, and we don't know where it is, and we can find Cepheids and measure their periods, we can infer their luminosities. And their luminosity combined with their apparent brightness can give their distance, because we know that their light declines with the inverse square of the distance. And that's the method that Hubble used. And you see on the right, the photographic plate, the discovery plate, where excitedly he marks VAR exclamation as he finds an object which in sequential photographic plates taken over a period of weeks has clearly varied in brightness and he believes to be a Cepheid variable. We can imagine how excited he might have been when he saw this. And so the distance to M31 can follow from this. Hubble's first observation actually was in error because his calibration of the Cepheid period luminosity relationship was wrong, but he derived a distance of 900,000 light years, almost 1,000,000 light years, and that is far larger than the Milky Way size of 100,000 light years. And so, in this discovery in 1922 and 23, he showed that M31, and by extension, some of the other spiral nebulae, are distant systems of stars. And in a stroke, he expanded the size of the known universe by an order of magnitude. Now, Hubble's result, to be fair, and because he did tend to claim more of the credit than he was due, depended crucially on earlier work by Henrietta Leavitt, who we've met as one of the computers at Harvard College Observatory. She had studied the light curves of Cepheid variables and discovered many of them, and she calibrated the crucial relationship that Hubble used to measure the distance to the Cepheid he found in M31. Through her career, Leavitt extended the distance measurement tool of Cepheid variables from hundreds of light years in the nearby Milky Way to 20 million light years and hundreds of galaxies. In fact, the Cepheid distance measurement technique is still used by astronomers and was used by the Hubble Space Telescope in one of its first three key projects just after launch. This work also, of course, depended on another unsung hero, forgotten in the mists of history, John Goodrick, Englishman who discovered Delta Cephei, the first Cepheid variable, in 1784. Goodrick has a sad story. He became deaf in early childhood, and because at the time deafness was associated with mental illness, people were stigmatized for being deaf, and so he was put in special schools where he got a very bad education. But he was brilliant, and he used telescopes in his spare time and made this discovery when he was barely a teenager. Of course, he risked his life by observing under all conditions in the British damp weather, and he died of pneumonia at age 22. So we never know what he might have done in the rest of his career. Astronomers have distance units appropriate to these new scales, so let's introduce these distance units. The typical distance between stars is a parsec, which is just over 3 light years, 6 trillion kilometers. So that's a natural star-to-star distance. The typical distance between galaxies is about 1,000,000 parsecs, or 3 million light years, and that's an incredible 10 billion billion kilometers. And as we get to the size of the observable universe, which we're coming to, that size is about 10 gigaparsecs, or 10 billion parsecs, or 33 billion light years, And that's an almost unimaginable number, a one with 23 zeros after it, kilometers. So these are the distance scales of the universe that we have to use when we move beyond the Milky Way galaxy. When we measure distances in astronomy, we actually have to use a range of tools because each method is only good for a certain range of distances. So we have to calibrate the nearby distances and measure them accurately, and then get a calibration for the next method, and then extend it and calibrate the third method and the fourth and so on. In that way, we bootstrap our way out, like trying to climb a building by attaching ladders on top of ladders and hoping they don't get too rickety and we fall. So we can see at the base of the pyramid of distance measurements is the solar system itself. And there our distance measurements are completely accurate because they're from radar imaging and we know the speed of light very well. To the nearby stars and distances of a few hundred light years, we also have very direct measurements through parallax. That's essentially trigonometry. But it's beyond that for significant regions in the Milky Way where we start to get a little less certain. Basically, we have to start comparing the properties of groups of stars formed in clusters to each other and measuring relative distances that way. That's called main sequence fitting. To the nearest galaxies, we use the method that Leavitt developed and Hubble perfected for M31, the Cepheid variables. And that takes us out to distances about 20 or 30 million light years. Beyond that, we actually have to use completely different set of methods that are less certain and only give distances accurate to 10 or 15%. And these involve the wholesale properties of galaxies, supernovae, which die with a well-calibrated brightness when they're in a binary system, and various other more subtle methods. And by this chain of methods, we actually can measure the size of the entire universe. There are many types of galaxies, and we see examples here. There is a barred spiral. There is a regular spiral. We have a slight bar in our galaxy, so we're more like the top right example of a spiral. There are also elliptical galaxies with smooth distributions and lenticular galaxies, which have some dust at the center. And then there are galaxies that don't have a high degree of symmetry, the irregular galaxies, and those that are peculiar, probably because they're interacting or something strange is going on in their nuclei. Hubble invented a sequence of galaxies as he started to classify galaxies and take deep images of many of them, hundreds, even thousands. And he originally thought the sequence he put together was an evolutionary sequence. You see it in a sort of tuning fork pattern where you have smooth, round, red elliptical galaxies at the apex of the tuning fork, and they branch into the regular spirals and then the barred spirals as the two branches of the tuning fork. He thought this was an evolutionary sequence, but we know that's not true now. Galaxies cannot interconvert from young spiral star galaxies to elliptical old galaxies. It seems like they might as the stars age, but their structures are so different that they cannot change one to another. Here's a more modern version of Hubble's tuning fork diagram, giving the rich diversity of galaxies we can see, in this case with the Spitzer infrared telescope. But it's the same idea. We have smooth early type galaxies with old star populations on the left, and then bifurcating into normal and barred spiral galaxies, the range of morphologies we see. Remember, there's also orientation. So some spirals we see edge on and some we see face on with the arms in view. Elliptical galaxies are more or less symmetric, and so their view doesn't depend on orientation very much. We also were able to put together, and Hubble started this work, a sequence that compared the ages of galaxies. Because, independent of distance, we can look at the age of the stars in a galaxy, and so we can see that some stars are young and some stars are old, and the galaxies with young stars tend to look more irregular and less symmetric than the stars that are old. Elliptical galaxies have the oldest stars. Irregular galaxies and peculiar galaxies have the youngest stars, and spirals are somewhere in between. Let's take a trip through our galaxy, the Milky Way, and go all the way to the nearest large cluster of galaxies, Virgo. So this will be a trip through our galaxy and nearby familiar regions of star formation, 55 million light years to Virgo, and we'll end up passing through to the center of M87, a giant elliptical galaxy we now know to host a 3 billion solar mass black hole. Thank you.
still see is darker than before.
The music, in case you're wondering, was by Brian Eno, Before and After Science. Another surprise came when we realized that all galaxies have black holes, not just the Milky Way. Of course, the Copernican principle would lead us to wonder whether the Milky Way was unique or special. But it does turn out that all galaxies that we've measured so far have supermassive black holes at their centers. The Milky Way is just the nearest example because we live in it. The Milky Way's galaxy is quite small. 4 million solar masses. Some galaxies have black holes even 1,000 times larger. These black holes seem to be dormant active galaxies. In other words, they're not active at the moment, they're not shining brightly, and that's why it took a long time to know they were there. In fact, we had to use data, like the diagram here, where we measure with a spectrograph, in this case a spectrograph on the Hubble Space Telescope, by dropping a slit over the center of a galaxy and looking in the blue color-coded and red color-coded deviations for blue shift and red shift of stars near the nuclei, where the high velocities would have to be driven by a mass concentration. And so that's what reveals the black hole: high gas velocities or star velocities near the center in a very small region where the mass density is not explainable by a star cluster and has to be a black hole. There's also a relationship from all this work. Once we'd accumulated dozens or even hundreds of black hole mass measurements in the nearby universe, it became clear that the mass of the black hole was not randomly varying, but correlated very well with the mass of the central bulge of the galaxy, that is, the old stars near the center of a galaxy. The Milky Way fits on this relationship, down near the bottom left, because the Milky Way has a relatively small bulge, and so the black hole is modest in mass. But you can see here, for large bulges, or for elliptical galaxies, which are entirely old stars and so have enormous number of old stars, the masses of their black holes are large. This apparently universal relationship of black hole mass with old star mass in a galaxy is still not completely understood. Dark matter also is seen in other galaxies. It would have been strange if dark matter was unique to the Milky Way. It's seen in all galaxies, large and small, spiral and elliptical. And the tool for measuring it is, as in so much in astronomy, spectroscopy. We measure the motion of the gas or the stars throughout the galaxy to infer the total mass and see how it squares with the number of stars in the galaxy. In spirals, in the diagram on the left, we use the range of blue shift and red shift to give the rotation speed, and that leads to the rotation curve. We've already seen the example for the Milky Way. In elliptical galaxies, there is no disk of stars, so there we actually have to use the velocity spread of stars at any distance or size or scale of the galaxy to give their average speed. You see a schematic diagram of that on the right. And so larger velocity spread or dispersion indicates a larger mass driving those motions. The principle is the same, and in both cases, for early and late type galaxies, that is spirals and ellipticals, dark matter is present, and it dominates the normal mass of the galaxy. Here's an example of M33. So this is a nearby spiral galaxy showing just that phenomenon that was observed for the Milky Way. Observations from starlight show the rotation rising to the edge of the galaxy. You can see the galaxy on the left, out to a distance of 15,000 light years. What would be expected from the visible disk, if that was all the mass, is the dashed curve. And you can see it's much lower, speeds are half as much as are seen. We can actually extend this relationship by observing in neutral gas, which goes beyond the distance of the visible stars out to 30 or 40,000 light years, and those are the blue data points. And once again, they continue to rise, velocities rising, implying that the size of the dark matter halo in this galaxy is larger than the diagram you're seeing. It goes beyond 50,000 light years. And in fact, we think that dark matter halos of galaxies, beyond containing 6 or 7 times the total mass of visible stars, actually extend over 5 to 8 times the scale of the visible galaxy itself. Huge dark matter halos. It's an extraordinary result, and it came through the 1970s and the 1980s. And the person who deserves a huge amount of the credit is a woman called Vera Rubin, who I knew well. She unfortunately died a few years ago. She worked her career at the Carnegie Observatories, where she was a pioneer in measuring the rotation curves of spiral galaxies, always finding them to be flat and not declining. Now, early in her career, in the 70s and 80s, she met enormous amount of skepticism or open hostility for her claim of dark matter. And she just said, look at the data. That's what the data shows. Again, you only have two choices. You can throw out Newton's law of gravity, very unpopular thing to do, or decide that there's invisible matter that dominates the mass of galaxies. Vera Rubin plowed through this. She was perfectly able to be confident in her data and was not perturbed by criticism. She'd already had to struggle to get where she was. She was not allowed to enroll in Princeton for a PhD. They just returned her application unread because she was a woman, and it would be another 3 decades before Princeton admitted women to their PhD program in astronomy. She was the first woman to observe at the Palomar 200 inch. At that time, the astronomer stayed in a building that was literally called the monastery, and there was no women's bathroom. And so everything had to be changed just so that she could observe at the Palomar Observatory. Some people think she was slighted by not winning a Nobel Prize for her dark matter work before she died. But she won many awards in her life, and in fact, just last year, a wonderful telescope that's coming that Arizona made the primary and secondary mirrors for, the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope, has been named after her. And it's being constructed, you can see a diagram, the building model, in a beautiful mountaintop in Chile at the moment. And it will do the next level of surveys for dark matter in the universe in the next few decades. Dark matter also was shown by gravitational lensing. Here we see light coming directly from a distant galaxy. We also see that if there's a cluster in the way or a group of galaxies, light from a background galaxy would be bent or distorted. Remember, mass bends space-time. And so, looking towards that cluster and the distant galaxy, we see more distant galaxies bent, sheared, distorted, and magnified by the lensing. This is a phenomenon that's been seen many times, and it really shows that individual galaxies and clusters of galaxies have huge amounts of dark matter. We also see that individual galaxies, without a cluster being involved, are bent or distorted by dark matter. So in the cartoon vision on the right, we imagine light beams traveling through the universe, and they're wiggling and being distorted subtly by dark matter and visible matter in the universe. These distortions flex the dark matter, flex the light, and they lead to little ellipticities being added to what otherwise would be a circular beam of light. This distortion or shear is very subtle, 1 part in 1,000, but it actually can be measured with really good imaging. And so people have been able to find the distortion of light as it travels through this sea of dark matter. So dark matter is not just associated with galaxies, it's associated with clusters, and it's associated with the space between galaxies. In other words, the universe is permeated with dark matter. A beautiful experiment done about a decade ago in what is called the Bullet Cluster was able to test the idea of dark matter, its existence, and also its property of not interacting with normal matter. In this cluster and another one, the gas, which is in red, has collided and heated up to emit X-rays, while the dark matter, seen in blue, continued without an interaction. And so the two clusters just passed through each other in terms of their dark matter, but their visible matter, because it interacts with other visible matter, collided, heated up, and glowed in X-ray. So that's clear evidence that dark matter exists and dominates, but that it's not subject to electromagnetic radiation or collisions that would lead to it heating up and glowing. That's a fascinating experiment done with 1 or 2 clusters. Why are astronomers so confident that dark matter actually exists? Well, because the law of gravity has passed many tests. Newtonian gravity works really well in the solar system and beyond. And if we put dark matter into a computer simulation, seen in the cube on the left, and we evolve a smooth universe to one with structure after gravity has acted, we get a universe that looks like our universe, but only if we feed dark matter into the simulation. Another sign that dark matter must be part of the equation. What is the dark matter? Well, that's a big question. Biggest unanswered question in astronomy, perhaps. And so far, astronomers have only been able to rule things out, to do elimination. It can't be normal stars. The census of stars doesn't allow it. That was the first realization about dark matter 30 years ago. It also can't be substars, objects, or free-floating planets, because even though they were dark, they would gravitationally lens, and we haven't seen gravitational lensing from them. So they're ruled out too. We also think it cannot be black holes. Isolated black holes, of course, are dark, but stellar mass black holes result from the death of a massive star, and a supernova would precede the formation of the black hole, and we see no sign of the enormous energy produced in supernovae at the rate for black holes to be the dark matter. So that's actually very easy to rule out. What if it's tiny particles? So we go down from substellar objects and planets and we get to asteroids or rocks or boulders or even dust particles. It seems like it would be easy to hide a lot of those things in space. Maybe they're the dark matter. Nope. That's been ruled out 20 or so years ago too. Because even if that dark matter existed, it's subject to the ambient radiation from all the stars. And in simple thermodynamics, that radiation would heat up the dust particles and they'd glow in the infrared. When we got infrared telescopes, we were unable to see any glowing dust or rocks or boulders or comets or asteroids, and so we know that it doesn't exist. And that pretty much leaves one thing: weakly interacting subatomic particles, fundamental particles. And the best guess coming out of physics is a supersymmetric extension to the standard model of particle physics. What does that mean? Supersymmetry is a basic extension of standard particle physics that tries to unite the half-spin particles, called fermions, with the integer spin particles, called bosons, through a set of shadow particles at higher mass. So each of the standard particles, up and down quarks and electrons and muons and neutrinos and so on, have their own counter particles, their shadow twins, at higher mass. And that's why they're hard to see, because their masses are higher and their decay times might be very short. This is an elegant theory in a way, because it unifies the individual types of particles that have been so far separate, but at the expense of creating a shadow set of particles. The good thing for dark matter is that a couple of these particles have the properties which might make them good dark matter candidates. The problem is, the theory's been around for over 3 decades, and people had hopes that a Large Hadron Collider at CERN would actually see evidence of these supersymmetric twin particles. And so far, none has been seen. So not only is supersymmetry theory in trouble, but the idea of any supersymmetric particles being the dark matter is also in trouble. Meanwhile, physicists are deep underground in mines using experiments to try and detect the dark matter particles directly. Because if dark matter permeates the galaxy, well, it permeates the solar system too, and it's in the Earth and passes through us, interacting very weakly with matter. And so people have put large solid-state detectors shielded from cosmic rays by being in mines deep underground and looking for very occasional interactions of dark matter particles with their detector, literally by physical recoil, by collisions in the semiconductor detector. So far, no evidence of dark matter has been seen. The curve on this diagram indicates the limits on dark matter particles from an existing set of experiments. The blue line is where theory says the dark matter particles should be. And you can see that the limits from experiment are approaching what theory says should be out there for dark matter, indicating that if these experiments continue to fail to find dark matter, then even the particle explanation for dark matter will be in trouble in a few years. So we need to stay tuned. And that's the end of this topic.